So before we start, a small few keywords. So when I'm going to explain certain things, if you feel asking any questions, so you can drop your questions in the chat or in the Q&A section. So if I take some pause, so I'm definitely going to answer all your questions and all your doubts. And yeah, if you want to contact us, so the details will be shared at during the session. So feel free to reach out to us. To Koenig. So it seems like now it's the time. So let's start the webinar. A very warm welcome to all of my friends who have joined into this particular webinar. And today's topic is fortifying the flow, safeguarding the supply chain. Supply chain is very, very important in our global economy. And we will try to understand all the security risks that comes into picture, how different types of threat vectors are going to cause some disruption in the global supply chain. So before we move on, a small introduction. My name is Argadeep Banerjee, and I am a corporate trainer. I basically give hands-on training on different cybersecurity certification courses. I am having around 5 years of experience, and basically I love consuming knowledge and sharing it as well. So I hope you all are going to enjoy this webinar. So please hang on and let's see how it goes. So the flow of the webinar is going to be very simple. We are going to understand what exactly supply chain is, how important it is for global economy, how does supply chain security works, what are the challenges that we are going to face in supply chain, and we will talk about some case studies to understand what are the impacts when some kind of attacks are going to take place on a supply chain of any organization. Okay, so starting with what exactly a supply chain is. Now, to understand that, we can take example of any product that we are using right now, whether it is our computer, whether it is our mobile phone, whether it is our router, whether it is the chair or the table on which we are sitting. All these things, we can take it as a product. And when we try to understand how this product is created and how it reaches to us, so we will be able to understand the entire process of supply chain. Now, there are certain keywords like producers. So these are basically, you can say, an organization or people who are going to make or grow raw materials for goods. Then there will be vendors which are going to buy and sell the materials, manufacturers who are going to manufacture it, the end product, transporters who are going to transport that particular product from one place to other, even though transporters are going to play a role in between the entire supply chain. Supply chain manager, it is basically people who are going to ensure that the entire transaction is taking place in a smooth way. So they're going to act as a middleman, and they're going to see all the process of the chain is working fine. Then there will be retailers. Those are basically the shops from where we buy product. And consumers are us, the end users, who want to buy a product or a type of service. Now, these components, when these are connected together, you will able to see a proper cyclic chain. And that is what supply chain is. And when we talk about this entire process, this is how a business works. This is how an economy runs. So when we talk about this particular topic of supply chain, there are like a lot of aspects of security which we need to discuss. And we need to understand the risks involved. And we will also try to understand what are the best practices that we can implement, what are the technologies that we can learn, and how we can grow in an organization and share our ideas to make sure that this particular global business is quite secured so that the criminals may not be able to penetrate into this, and they should not cause any large-scale destruction. Because it is very, very important. So in the upcoming few slides, you will get the proper idea why security is a big challenge in this particular domain called as supply chain. So if you see this particular diagram, you talk about any product, this diagram is going to satisfy it. Like, for example, when I was talking about my mobile phone, so the mobile phone is having a lot of components present. So to create those components, raw material is needed. So the raw material will be delivered from the source to the supplier using some way of logistics, then the supplier is going to send it further to the distributor. So the distributor is going to be a big organization, and the distributor is going to procure a lot of different raw materials from different suppliers. And the distributor is going to deal with the manufacturers. So the manufacturer is basically the company who is going to manufacture the mobile phone. And that particular manufacturer is going to ask for certain type of parts to the distributor. Distributor is going to check with the suppliers for those particular raw materials, for those parts. And the manufacturer is going to combine all those things and is going to create a product. Then again, you can see logistics is playing a very important role in this entire chain. So manufacturer is going to send that particular product to the retailer or the marketplace. And we as an end consumer, we are going to, you know, buy that particular product. And it completely depends on many factors. But, you know, like if the consumer is trying to buy certain things in a large scale, it's going to increase the demand of the product. And again, that entire chain is going to work in a very smooth way. A lot of challenges will be there. A lot of other factors comes into picture. But our main focus in this webinar is to deal with the security, a point of view of supply chain. Okay, now, as we talk about, as we discussed what exactly supply chain is, and I hope you got some idea how this entire thing is going to work. But what are the challenges of security in this domain? So these are some points that I have mentioned here: risk assessment and management, physical security, information security, product integrity, supplier security management, transportation security, regulatory compliances, incident response and recovery. Now, again, these are not just the only points, but these are like most common points that we can deal with the security aspect of supply chain. Some few more points can be added, some points can be removed, but it completely depends on organization to organization, how they are going to deal with their security of their supply chains. But we are just discussing the overall scenario, how exactly it works. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to take you a little bit more in depth about these terms and terminologies. Like, for example, if I talk about risk assessment and management, then what exactly that is? Like, comprehensive risk identification. Risk is always there. Okay, everywhere it is going, means risk is going to be there. But how dangerous it is, we need to predict it. Accordingly, we will take some preventive measures. We will create a proper plan according to our skills for accessing the risk. Okay, so mapping the supply chain and identifying the threats is a very important one. Then risk analysis and evaluation. So what is going to be the impact of that particular threat if it is implemented? Okay, creating some multiple different scenarios of those events and planning accordingly. We also need to deal with the third party suppliers, because when we talk about a product, so it's not always that the manufacturer is able to deal or the manufacturer is able to, you know, control all the components of that product. Sometimes they need to deal with some third party services as well. So we need to check with the supplier audits, supplier developments, and all those things. Then technology and data utilization. Now, right now at this point of time, if you try to understand the supply chain, a huge amount of technology is getting involved and it is getting implemented, right? If you just go back 20 years, 30 years, 50 years, 100 and 200, 300 and 1000 years, you will able to know the differences. Like, back then, 1000 years back, mostly the chain was very much focused on local, a local environment. But right now, at this point of time, everything is a global one. So if we talk about any product, most probably some kind of raw material is getting imported or exported, right? Some organizations are buying that product, some organizations are selling it to some other organization. Okay, so that is how the supply chain has become a very global event right now. And technology is helping all these organizations to make it more efficient and more reliable using data. Advanced analytics, real-time monitoring, these are some features which will be implemented in large scale to make sure that the entire process is taking a smooth transaction. Then insurance and financial plannings, because something may go wrong. And if you don't have a proper backup, financial backup mostly, then it's going to be a big challenge. So you need to deal with that particular aspect as well. Okay. Insurance and financial reserves. So these all points comes under risk assessment and management. So basically you're trying to figure out the risks initially, and then you are going to create a proper plan according to those risks that you have identified. And accordingly, you will take all those preventive measures. What else? Physical security. Of course, yes. When you are going to deal with any particular product, so if you see the entire chain, physical security plays a very important role in multiple different steps of the supply chain, because chances are there that something can go wrong, like some kind of stealing activity can take place, or counterfeiting, right? Or some kind of illegal activity can take place during that entire process of sending the product or the raw material from one source to the other. During the process of that logistics, somewhere there, some kind of security challenges can arise. Even though if you are storing your product in a storage facility, that is also a place where you're going to look out for physical security. Right. So physical security is one of the aspects that that is very, very important in this particular chain. Transportation security. Now, there are multiple ways to transport the products. Okay, like you are going to use seaways, you're going to use airways, you're going to use roadways. Okay, so multiple different places are there. And in the upcoming slides, we are going to discuss about the frameworks that are designed to provide proper security to certain aspects. And that's something we will discuss. But right now, if you see in this entire diagram, you will see a lot of different steps are involved, like how the product is being shipped from source to destination and how many steps are involved in this entire process. Like you can see national borders. Okay. So sea transport is basically going to be a very reliable source of, transport mechanism. And there will be ports. In those ports, the checking is going to be done. The containers which are going to have goods, the containers should have some physical security aspect. So in the next slide, I'm going to show you how the technology is going to help you to make sure that you are able to track your product efficiently. And even the technology will also help you to deal with the physical security challenges of those kind of containers, which is going to have your goods inside it. Not only that, during the transport process, that is also a place, okay, loading, unloading place where, illegal goods can be added, or theft in the cargo stocks, okay, tampering with the cargo vehicle, loading unwanted goods into the container, okay, smuggling, terrorist activities, all those things are very big challenge when we talk about transport security. But yes, organizations are there. They have their own set of policies to deal with these kind of challenges. So it is also a very important aspect of entire supply chain. Then product integrity. You create a product, there are multiple factors that makes your product very much reliable, and that product is going to gain trust of the end user, which is nothing but the consumer. First thing is quality assurance. So your product should satisfy all the necessary standards. Regular inspections should be done. Testing and validation should be proper. Then traceability, tracking systems, batch numbers, lot tracking. These are very important so that you can just understand, or you can just trace your product from end to end. Like just for example, your mobile phone. Okay, it's a product. Now, this mobile phone right now at this point of time can be used for a lot of illegal activities if it goes to a wrong hand. But there should be some way to know that, okay, this product is from this particular manufacturer, and the manufacturer should have some kind of ways to identify that particular product uniquely. So they will have some IMEI codes. Okay, they will have some MAC address which are hard coded for that device. Okay, so there are different ways by which the mobile can be traced. Right. Then secure packaging, tamper proof, protective packaging, standardized packaging. Because when you are buying as an end user or a consumer, if you are buying a product, and during that process, if the product is tampered, like the packaging is tampered, and you might have seen a lot of news you are ordering something from e-commerce website, you ordered a laptop and you are receiving a soap inside that laptop box. Right? Those kind of scenarios are very common, because nowadays e-commerce business is huge, tremendous. And dealing with this kind of challenge is very important. So organizations, they create their own security standards. They come up with different technologies. They implement like RFID tags. Okay, they create different types of packaging. Okay, and they try to secure that entire process. So when the product is getting delivered from the warehouse to the end user, it should be properly secured without any kind of tamper or without any kind of modifications done on that particular parcel. Okay. Authentication and anti-counterfeiting measures, watermarks, authentication tools, serial numbering, these are all going to be added. Handling and storage, proper handling procedures, optimized storage conditions, inventory management, these are also very important, because if you just take an example of any warehouse, of any e-commerce websites or any e-commerce business, they will have huge warehouse and they will have thousands or millions of products present there. And if they don't have a proper mechanism of handling and storage, then it's going to be a big challenge for the business, because a lot of security challenges comes into picture. Like, there might be someone who is going to steal some small products. There might be someone who are going to tamper with those products. So I ordered a phone. It's an Apple phone, but I received a Xiaomi Mi. So, you know, these kind of challenges can take place. Customer feedback and complaint handlings. Very, very important part. Okay. The reason is, if I'm opting or if I'm buying a product and if I'm not satisfied, or if there are some features which I want the, which I want the organizations to take care of, or, some kind of ideas I'm trying to share, or suppose if something is not working, I need to talk with the product owner, means the organization, the vendor, and they need to deal with these challenges in a very efficient manner. So you might have seen it, like in many cases, the most reliable product is one which is having a better complaint handling and better customer feedbacks. Like if you go to any e-commerce websites, you're going to look for the product, you're going to see the reviews, you're going to see all the customer reviews, like whether the customer was satisfied with the product, whether the customer was satisfied with the unknown event, like the product was damaged, but the organization was able to replace the particular damaged product in a particular time frame. So those things play a very important role. Documentation and risk management, detailed records, transparency, mitigation plans, risk assessments. So all these terms are going to play an important role in product integrity. Now, this is very important for business, because when you put your trust as an end consumer, when you put your trust on the product, it is going to help the business to grow. Okay, so it's a two-way thing. Then see, when we talk about the packaging, so heat shrink bands, tamper evident closures, okay, decorative tamper evident levels. Now, I'm from India. So when I order food from certain places using some app, so they have their own way of packaging. So they ensure that the packaging is, if the packaging is tampered a little bit, complain it. And they also have a good way of handling consumer complaints. And they are quite fast. Same as with Koenig. So Koenig is basically the organization where I'm working as a full-time trainer. And we provide certification courses. And we have our online lab setups. And we have all different portals. So during the class or after the class, if you face any difficulties, we have our support team to help you out with all those challenges. Right. Similarly, if you see the right side diagram, there is this device which is basically placed in these big containers, and these kind of devices are going to automate the entire process of security, like illegal lock picking, rapid speed change, vandalism, vibrations, and many more features are there. GPS connectivity will be placed on that particular device, so you can track your shipment in a regular, real-time fashion. Okay, so these technologies getting implemented in this entire process of supply chain will help both consumers as well as the manufacturers and other domains which are part of this entire chain. Okay, next. Regulatory compliance. It is also very important because right now we are dealing with a global supply chain, right? And some countries are going to develop or some countries are going to create certain type of products. You can say it as raw materials, and those countries are going to share it, or it's going to export them. And other countries who are having the manufacturing plant present in their location, they're going to import them. So this entire process needs to be properly followed. Otherwise, there are like a lot of criminals out there who are going to take advantage of it to perform smuggling or any kind of illegal activities. So there are different types of security compliances which are designed to deal with certain type of challenges. Now, there are so many of them, but I have mentioned a couple of them. Okay, so the one is custom trade partnership against terrorism. Okay, so it's basically a voluntary supply chain security program led by US Customs. So their main focus is to provide a proper security mechanism for private companies to deal with terrorism. Then there is authorized economic operator. It's basically a program under the World Custom Organization Safe Framework Standards. These are like very complicated terms, but it's like you can understand in this way, some set of rules or policies which are designed to provide some high level security. Okay. And this particular policy was designed for European Union countries mostly, but they also deal with CTPAT, which is the first one in the US, and similarly other initiative in other countries. So see, some countries, they have created some set of frameworks, some compliances, and it is very much possible that those compliances are also getting implemented other countries as well. According to their own requirements, they modify it, and that's how they implement it. Okay. Similarly, European Union Aviation Security Regulations, which is quite important to monitor the cargoes which goes through airways. Okay. So regulations such as air cargo, mail carrier, they will just check out all those cargoes, and those cargoes should follow the security standards of European Union. Then International Ship and Port Facility Security Code, ISPS. It's basically a set of measures which is going to check the security of ships and port facilities. It is very, very important because the majority of the transport that takes place in this entire supply chain is done through ships. It's more cheap, cost efficient, more reliable. General data protection regulation. Now, it's not just about the physical security of this entire chain, because we also need to deal with the data as well. Because right now, if you just see all the domains in this entire world, majority of them are connected to some or the other form of internet. They are generating data. And when data comes into picture, security is also a big concern at this point of time. So one of the very interesting policy that was designed is GDPR, General Data Protection Regulation. So it is basically created to satisfy the data privacy of users in EU region. Okay, it also affects the supply chain operations that handles personal data, requiring robust data protection measures. Like one example I would definitely like to add here is, you all are familiar with Meta, parent company of Facebook. And Meta was fined $1.2 billion because they breached GDPR policy. So what they did is they were collecting user data from EU and they were sending that data to some servers in US. And when you got to know that, and they fined Meta with $1.2 billion. So you can just imagine why these all regulatory frameworks are needed. Next. If you see in the right-hand side diagram, which is incident response plan, okay, so organizations, they will have a particular method of dealing with these all challenges like incident response and access management, preparation, detecting and analysis, containment, eradication and review. So there is a proper chain which the particular team is going to follow. So some kind of event took place, an incident is going to be generated, then they're going to detect the source of that particular event, then they will try to contain it. Then they will try to again test it, whether it is absolutely gone or not. Then they will review it. And accordingly, that cycle goes on. If you talk about the left-hand side diagram, steps to implement regulatory compliance. So you can see there are like a couple of steps here. That is basically appoint a compliance officer who is going to identify which regulations are best for your business. Then conduct functional gap analysis. Then picking up the right compliance tool. Training the employees. Setting up the monitoring feature. Conducting internal audits to understand more about the loopholes. Documenting the controls. Prepare for regular audits and publish certifications. So this is the entire cycle of implementing regulatory compliances inside any organization. Like regulatory compliances like GDPR is one, HIPAA is one, okay, ISO 27000 is one, like that. SDLC process, secure development of secure coding practices, you can say. So basically, first, the development of that application will take place. Second, the focus will be on how the security aspect will be taken care for that application. Requirements, design, development of that application, testing it, deployment. That is how application is created and that is how it is deployed. But when we talk about the security aspect, understanding the risks, threat modeling, design review, static analysis, dynamic analysis, secure testing, security testing and code reviews, then security assessment and secure configuration. So those are basically certain ways of making that application more secure by practicing secure coding practices. All right. So next, moving on. One of the important aspects, information security. Very, very important in this scenario because at the end, all these organizations, they will generate a huge amount of data. Organization needs to keep customer data. Organization needs to keep a proper product data. All their informations are very, very crucial. And in that aspect, there are certain key terms which are very, very important for dealing with information security. When we talk about information security, it is just one part of cybersecurity that deals with providing security to the piece of data. Like, for example, one of the implementations will be access control, right? Authentication, authorization, least privilege. So basically, employees will have different designation. So some employees who are just, you know, part of a particular team, they cannot access some restricted data. They need to authenticate themselves for certain type of services. Then the system is going to authorize whether this particular person can access these set of files from the database or not. Okay. Having some proper privilege management is also very important. When we talk about data protections, encryption, there should be certain standards for securing your data, whether the data is in transit or whether the data is in rest. Data masking, secure backup, very, very important. Secure backup is one of the key aspects that I want to focus because nowadays you will see a lot of different data breaches taking place and DDoS attacks are also increasing. And ransomware attacks are also it's also very important. And these different types of cyber attacks are going to, cause a huge trouble for organization and organization may lose their secure data or their important data. So having a proper mechanism of data backup is very, very important. Then there is one aspect of network security where firewalls, intrusion detection systems, okay, network segmentation. So network segmentation is nothing but dividing the network into smaller chunks so that it becomes easy for the administrators to maintain it. Secure communication protocols. Okay, so like, for example, if you try to access a website, you are not going to use HTTP protocol because it is unsecured. You're going to rely on HTTPS, which is the secured one. Okay, then supplier and partner security because, see, it's a very complex term, okay? Because like when you create a product or suppose, for example, you're creating a software on an application, there will be chances that you're going to use some third-party libraries or you're going to use some open source libraries, okay? And at that point of time, the risk increases for your application because you are relying on some third party and the third party, whether they are following certain set of security principles or not, that completely depends on many factors. And if that third-party dependency is getting compromised, your main application will get compromised even if you follow all the security aspects properly. Now, in the case studies, I'm going to show you some good example, like how SolarWinds was one of such thing that took place. Okay. And cybersecurity training is very important because it has been noted that the easiest targets are not computers, but humans. Hacking humans is more easy than hacking computers. And social engineering is one such way how it is done. And still it is done. Now the attack methods are becoming more complex day by day. But yep, cybersecurity training to each and every employee, the basic training is very, very important. Creating phishing simulations so that the employees will not fall into these traps. Security awareness programs should be conducted on quarterly, half yearly, or once in a year basis, just to check whether your employees are up to mark or not. Incident response and recovery, again, it was already included before, but right now also it's going to be part of information security. So there should be a proper mechanism of handling incidents. Okay, forensic analysis is very, very important because if some kind of attacks took place on the organization and some kind of event happened, then the forensic investigators will be the one who will come into picture, try to identify the root cause of it, try to figure out who that actual culprit is, and try to identify all those places which were used to conduct that attack so that the preventive measures can be taken accordingly. And as we have already seen, secure software development, where threat intelligence is one such aspect, monitoring, regulatory compliances will be combined together to deal with it. Okay, so when we talk about authentication, so basically as an end user, for example, suppose if I want to access my Gmail account, so I need to authenticate myself using a username and password. And suppose I'm working in an organization and there is a shared drive, and I'm trying to access some files or some data. And if I don't have the authorization, then I may not access it. So there will be a proper system who is going to check. Mostly Active Directory environment is widely used in organization. And a set of groups are created, set of policies are written down. So it's going to check whether my user profile is having proper access or not. Then if you see the next diagram, the bottom one, it's a small diagram that represents how a network security looks like. So firewalls are basically the frontline security of a network. Okay, then there will be intrusion detection and prevention systems. They are going to monitor the network traffic internally for malicious contents. Okay, so having a proper secured network is very, very important for organizations. Then when I'm talking about global supply chain security, whatever we have discussed right now, these all points, these all factors are going to play an important role in this particular term. Yes or no? Because right now, the entire supply chain is very much global, directly or indirectly, you talk about. You just see around you, whatever the products that you are trying to whatever the products that you are using right now, just try to break it, try to understand the source from where it was originated, or the materials from where it was procured by the manufacturer, and the manufacturer location where exactly that company is situated, and where you are right now. So it will give you the complete idea that, okay, it is very much true that whatever the products that we are using, it's part of the global supply chain. And if the global supply chain is getting impacted due to wars, due to cyber espionage, due to cyber threats, due to some other challenges, then it's going to cause a very big chaos. Okay. And we have seen it, right? Pandemics. Pandemics was a very bad situation. Okay. So these are some, you know, challenges that we are going to discuss right now. Some points that can help us to understand more, like globalization. So geopolitical risks, cultural and operational differences, and so on. It will also impact the supply chain. Cybersecurity threats, of course, yes, because as the technology is evolving, the sectors, okay, the different sectors, whether it is healthcare, whether it is defense, whether it is manufacturing, all these sectors are getting connected to the internet in some or the other form, generating huge amount of data. So security will be the concern. Physical security, we have seen it, theft, tampering, counterfeiting, pilferage. Pilferage is basically small stealings that can take place if a proper mechanism is not present in the storage sections. Okay, regulatory compliances, we have seen it, how these different set of regulatory compliance frameworks are designed to tackle different types of challenges. Transparency and visibility, okay, that is also a big challenge. Lack of end-to-end visibility, data silos. Now, for example, suppose I am a software development company. I create a software and I have given, a contract to a third party. And the third party responsibility is to deal with certain part of my software. Now, I, trust that third party because there are some contracts that we need to, come to a mutual understanding. And that is how the third party is going to satisfy my requirement. But if the third party is not following a best security practices, and if due to some or the other reason, okay, their side of the product got compromised, which is going to affect my main product. So it's basically due to many factors, because they might have lied me. They have taken the contract and they are also going for some more, outsourcing that some part of that particular project. Okay, so lack of end-to-end visibility is a big challenge in these kind of situations. Natural disasters and pandemics. So that's what I was talking about, right? 2020, 2021 was a big challenge for the global economy, okay, because pandemic came into picture, and natural disasters like earthquakes, tsunamis, okay, or any other natural calamities that can take place can also impact local or global supply chain. Technology integration is also a big challenge because right now, as technology is evolving, the main challenge is to implement it in this entire framework. Okay, so upgrading from the old legacy system to the new systems, it's a big challenge. Now, just for an example, right now what we are using these computers, we think it is very much powerful, but a very big research and development is taking place for quantum computers. Now, in near future, when quantum computers becomes a reality, then implementing those means that particular technology to the current framework will be a challenge. But yes, engineers are there, scientists are there, people are there with brains. They are going to take care of it. Human factors are also a big challenge. Insider threats, many times espionage takes place. Okay, corporate espionage is also such case where people or employee who was working in an organization was responsible for revealing sensitive information or stealing and leaking it out. Okay, so insider threats are a big challenge. Training and awareness, of course, employees needs to be trained on these all aspects properly. And the training should be conducted in a short time durations. Economic pressures, those are like, politics also comes into picture when we talk about it. Market pressures, cost constraints. Okay, product integrity, we have discussed that, like how to deal with quality controls, counterfeiting. Okay, so these all are biggest challenge. And to make sure that the supply chain is working properly for any given product, to make sure the security aspects are taken care properly, we need to work on these particular challenges. We need to figure out solutions that can help us, to deal with these set of challenges. Okay, now just to give you some more context, like how these all how different types of attacks are going to take place, and that's going to interrupt the entire supply chain of a particular product of an organization. So we can talk about some case studies. Moovit is a very interesting example, and Moovit is an application which was used for secure file or data transfer. It was used by at least like 30,000 Moovit was having around like 30,000 plus customers. Okay, and what happened is the application was having a zero-day vulnerability, and hackers, they took advantage of this zero-day vulnerability and they performed something called as SQL injection, by which they were able to access the database of Moovit application, and they stole customers' data of Moovit. So Klopp is a ransomware gang name, and they were responsible for performing this attack. They were also responsible for performing some targeted attack, 3,000 US organizations and over 8,000 global organizations. Now, victim of the attacks were BBC, British Airways, Boots, and Aer Lingus, whose staff data, national insurance numbers, and bank details were stolen. So you can just imagine, a lot of different consumers are there. Okay, like you can see BBC, British Airways, and all. They were all using a particular application, MoveIt, and the MoveIt was having a very dangerous vulnerability, and they have no idea. They trusted the MoveIt application, and they were using it for a long time. But due to a small, you know, vulnerability, those company who were the consumer, their data got lost, and they were the victim of this entire attack. Similarly, if you see SolarWinds example, which was quite famous. So SolarWinds is an IT infrastructure management software, and their main product was Orion, which was used by 33,000 customers globally. And some or the other way, hackers were able to find a way to install a backdoor. Now, if you don't know backdoor, it's a malicious piece of software, or you can say a piece of program code, which gives control to the hacker. Okay, so backdoor was installed in the actual version of Orion. Okay, the software means the software source code got compromised. No one has any idea about it. So the software owner is SolarWinds. They have no idea. And the consumers, okay, the customers, they have no idea. And when they installed the latest update of that software, their infrastructures got compromised. So the backdoor got installed on SolarWinds client's infra. It allows the hacker to impersonate accounts and users of victim organization. It allows the hacker to access files and systems data. More than 18,000 customers of SolarWinds, they applied for that particular latest update of Orion, and they got compromised, and they have no idea. And it impacted the entire supply chain, right? Similarly, one more interesting one is Petya ransomware. Okay, it came into picture in June 27, 2017. And was reported or was notified by NCCIC, National Cyber Security. There is one group. They notified this Petya malware events. Okay, and it was affecting multiple countries and multiple sectors. What it does is, when it infects a computer, it's going to encrypt the entire hard disk, and it's going to change the file extensions so that it becomes near to impossible for the end users to access their files from that computer. And how it is spread? So Windows, back in 2017, Windows machine or Windows product have seen very serious zero-day vulnerabilities. Okay, so there was Eternal Blue, WannaCry ransomware took place just in May month in 2017. And there was a vulnerability in Windows 7 and Windows 8 and 10 products also. SMB was the vulnerability. SMB service was vulnerable, and this particular malware that used the same kind of vulnerability to exploit, and it spread all across the network on all the Windows machines and encrypted the data. And WannaCry was a ransomware attack similar to WannaCry. This particular ransomware also used a small number of wallet address and demanded only $300. Okay, so that's quite interesting, right? The malware campaign has infected organizations in several sectors: finance, transport, energy, commercial, healthcare. So it's impacting a large group of industries and impacting their business, right? These all things are, you know, very, very dangerous when you see it through a different lens. When you are part of this cybersecurity domain, you will able to understand the risks that is involved. The threat vectors are getting more and more complicated. And yes, we all security engineers need to improve our knowledge and skill sets. We need to increase that knowledge. And that's how we will able to stay relevant, and we will able to stay useful for big organizations, and we can make it more secure and deal with these kind of challenges. There are some other different types of attacks that took place. So you can see these are some lists. Applied Materials, it's a semiconductor giant. They also faced a targeted attack. Resulting loss is $250 million. Equifax, credit reporting company suffered a massive data breach, affected 147 million customers. CC Cleaner, an application which is used for optimizing, and it got compromised. A malware was installed on the victim's computer. The complete supply chain of the software was affected. Panasonic, 2021, data breach was disclosed. A unique supply chain attack compromising data that business shares as a part of supply chain due to third parties' illegal access to Panasonic server. Wipro, 2020, hackers used a supply chain attack to gain access to the company's network, steal sensitive client data, and attackers used Wipro company's computers to launch phishing attacks to the customers. Quite weird and quite interesting. And these all are just few examples. If you just do some research, you will see a huge list of attacks, cyber attacks mostly, and different other aspects that comes into picture, which cause a big challenge for the global supply chain. Now, just to give you some more idea, that there are some places like ExploitDB. Okay, it's a database which is going to have some exploit codes, like just piece of program codes which are used to target some vulnerable applications. So hackers are mostly going to use these kind of places, okay, to figure out vulnerable applications, to get some exploit codes and target their victims and so on. Similar to that, there is something called a CVE metry. Okay. CVE metry is basically an organization which keeps a track of vulnerabilities, and a metry attack framework. So they have a very interesting framework that helps you to understand how hackers are going to perform these attacks. They also have, they also keep a track of all the threat vectors and their process of performing these dangerous attacks. So if you want, you can go to those websites, CVE and Mitri, and you can understand more about the dangerous attacks in a detailed fashion. There is a process called a cyber threat hunting, which many security organizations are going to follow. So they will try to stay one step ahead of hackers. So they will do their homeworks. They will try to figure out the latest threats. They will try to create a scenario. They will try to understand all the ways how it can be conducted, and they will take preventive measures accordingly, so that if these kind of attacks takes place, so the organization will able to deal with it. Okay. Then there are different types of darknet marketplaces. So a couple of them I have just mentioned here. One of them is a clearnet market. Like clearnet is like normally anyone can access. And this forum name is Breach Forum. Recently, it got busted by FBI and other security agencies. Breach Forum was present. Okay, you can normally use your Google search engine to search for it. And in this particular forum, you will get many things. Okay, so leaked data, okay, different types of legal, illegal activities takes place. On the right hand side, Torum Forum, which got closed couple of years back, but it was one of the best forum in darknet, where all these other, again, same things you will able to find. The current one which is there and the most popular in darknet is Dread Forum. Okay, it's kind of a marketplace. So these kind of forum places are one where hackers are going to sell their exploits, they're going to sell their vulnerabilities, they're going to do business. Okay, all sorts of legal, illegal activities takes place there. And apart from that, security engineer's task is to stay up to date. So as a security engineer, I'm going to have accounts in all these places, and I'm going to just monitor what kind of events are taking place, what kind of activities taking place. So I'm going to keep myself up to date with these challenges. And those challenges and those data, I'm going to use it, analyze it, and will use that particular information for security measures for my organization. So it's basically, understanding the threats and taking preventive measures in hand. And there are multiple different places where these all, exploits, vulnerabilities are sold. Like Zerodium in was such place. Okay, so like a product called as phone or mobile phone, which is having application. Okay, operating system is nothing but an application. So Android or iOS. So they can also have vulnerabilities. And these vulnerabilities are, you know, like people are going to write some piece of program code which can help to hack these phones. And there are marketplaces which are going to buy those particular piece of code for millions of dollars. And it's a very big business, very complicated business that revolves around all these aspects. All right. So that's all from my side. If you have any questions, anything to ask, feel free to ask me, drop in the Q&A section. I will answer. And at the end, I just want to say it's all about the mindset. So you need to think in a certain way to understand more about the security challenges, whether it is in any domain or whether you talk about the entire cybersecurity. You need to create that mindset. The mindset of hacker, slowly and steadily, you will able to develop that, which will help you in a long run. So that's all from my side. And now we can have the Q&A. Okay, I think I have received some set of questions. So let me just check it out. Okay, you want this slide? Sure, we can try to share it out in the chat. Just give me a minute, please. So anyone having any questions, anything to ask, feel free to ask me. And if nothing is there, if you have enjoyed this session, there is the feedback form in the chat. Please take out a little bit of time and give the feedback. This entire session was recorded, so you can find this recording in YouTube. Okay, so most probably Koenig is going to upload this entire session in a couple of days in YouTube. So there you can access this entire session. And I think there is some issue with my slides. So once it loads, I will try to share it. See, there are different set of certification courses. Okay. And you can opt for it, because if you see the overall scenario, there are multiple places where cybersecurity engineers are going to come into picture. And that will be one of the useful thing. Just a minute. All right. So let me upload it. Actually, I'm sorry. I don't think so. We have a dedicated course for supply chain security management. But yes, it can be created. It depends on the requirement. So you can check with our team and they can help you out more about this particular topic and this term. So guys, if you want this PDF, I'm just uploading it in the chat. So you can download it from this chat. Okay, so this Go file link will help you to download this entire PDF, means entire slide in PDF form.
Thank you, Arkadeep, for that lovely session. And thank you, everyone, for joining. I hope there is no further questions regarding this webinar. Kindly do fill in your attendance sheets for your webinar certificates. And if anybody wants to have this training with us, I've shared my email in the chat. Kindly forward me your details so that our expert can get back to you with the required details. So there was a question on the PDF. So Arkadeep have shared, but nevertheless, he has to delete it because we're not allowed to have share the slides. As for that, you need to pay for these trainings. All right. If anybody wants to have this training, I'll be again sharing my email in the chat. Kindly forward me your details so that our expert can get back to you with the best possible quote for this training. And anything else, we have another 2 minutes left, Arkadeep. We can help for the next 2 minutes and we can wind up.
Sure.
Thank you, everyone.
Okay, I got a question. If you go with SaaS application, will this help eliminate information security and risk compliance? No, the challenges will always be there. It doesn't matter if you go with cloud services. SaaS is a cloud service, right? Yeah, like some challenges will be reduced, but there will still be those risks involved. So when you go to cloud security concepts or that entire domain, you will be able to understand more about it. So risk is always there. Any other queries, guys? Anything else? I hope you all have enjoyed this session. So feel free to share your feedbacks, because your feedbacks are very important. It's going to help us to improve further, and these kind of creative contents, we can bring it for you all. And any kind of suggestions are there, feel free to drop it in the feedback so that we can improve and we can bring something more interesting next time. So there isn't any dedicated course present right now, but it can be created a custom course. We can design on it on this entire domain. And you can check with our team. Okay, so according to the requirements, we can work on it and we can create a course, because that's what I do. So if you all are interested, we can work on that. And yes, of course, that can be done. The recordings, actually, it's getting recorded. So it's going to get uploaded in our YouTube channel. So you can follow us on YouTube. And most probably in 1 or 2 days, the videos will get uploaded in Koenig YouTube channel. PSP, okay, I got a question. Do you also do PSP? I'm sorry, I am very bad with the short form. So can you please tell me what is PSP? A certificate of participation will be provided once you submit the attendance link and the feedback form. So you will receive the certificate of participation for this webinar on your mail.
So Argadeep, I'd like to take this for that. Yeah. Once you fill the attendance sheet, you'll receive a mail from our side, as the process is automated now. So you'll receive a mail from our side, which contains the login credentials of our portal. So you have to log into that portal and download your webinar certificates. Thank you, Argadeep. Thank you for that session. It was lovely to have you as usual. And thank you everyone for joining. Bye-bye. See you in the upcoming webinars. Bye.
Thank you all. Bye-bye.